I'm Alicia from the Machine Teaching Group.
And this is Johan.
So there is an increasing demand for ML models. And we see this demand because there are lots and lots of tasks in our daily lives that could benefit from machine learning. And we think that this increasing demand cannot be met with just developing the machine learning algorithms and focusing on that problem. So what we're doing is focusing on something called machine teaching. So that's making teaching machines easy, fast, and accessible for anyone. And we want to increase the efficacy and the productivity of the teachers giving the learners or the ML algorithms. So we take our inspiration from software engineering, and there's a lot of different concepts that can be applied in this space. So what we're going to show you today is PICL, or the Platform for Interactive Concept Learning, which demonstrates these principles in a web-based UI, and it allows one person with just domain knowledge about how to build, or about addresses, to build an actual address extractor from text documents. So I'll hand it off to Johan and let him show you how to do that.
Okay, so this is our tool, PICL. We're going to go through how to build an address extractor using PICL. So the first thing I'll do, I'll open a project I started. So I'm going to go into some of the details of each of the UI elements as we go along. But briefly, on the left, you'll see an area where we can see existing labels as we start adding them. In the middle is our kind of exploration pane where we see the examples of data as we explore the data set. The entities pane is us describing what is the data that we're trying to extract. The explanation pane, this is where we're explaining the features that's important for the model to learn. So the first thing we want to do when we want to build any kind of model is to find some positive examples. So we can do this, for example, by just doing a plain search. For addresses, we might want to search for, say, Pine Street. So we're going to search for some example of an address. And we see at the bottom here, it found an address. And now, because of our schema that we defined ourselves, we are going to label this particular example as being an address. And I see it occurs here as well. So let's label that as an address. Now, our schema, we said basically an address is something that has a street, it has a PO box, it has a city, a state, and a zip code. So we want to explain this to the model by labeling all the subparts as well. So we'll label this part as street. See what this happened here as well. City, Seattle. And you'll see that as we label something as a street, we implicitly label the street as not being a city. And the state is Washington. And here we don't have a zip code, but here we do have a zip code. So that's our zip code. So as we submit our label, we can now start training a model. And you'll see now in our label pane, we can see some of the examples appearing here. So this section here is an example of features. So this is where we explain to the system why do we think a certain example is an address, or why it's part of an address. For example, we could have something like address words. So if you see words like with that maybe address or contact or location, this is give us some clue of whether it is or why it is an address. I'm going to move towards a new model that is a bit more mature, that we've added quite a bit of labels, or actually not that many, maybe 50 labels or so. But it takes maybe 10 or 20 minutes to label an extractor to get to this point. Okay, so here you can see now many, many more labels as we've added them. The review model is what helps us to debug the system. So you can see a bunch of red boxes at the bottom, a bunch of green boxes at the top. So these are basically items that we've labeled as being addresses. So this box is a place where we say this is an address, And the red ones is where we've labeled things as being not addresses. So these parts are labeled as red because they're not addresses. The scale that you see here is the confidence of our current model as to whether it thinks it's an address or not. So ideally, you want all the green boxes to be at the top, meaning that things that we've labeled as being addresses are being predicted as addresses. And you want all the red things to be at the bottom, meaning that things that we've labeled as not addresses is being predicted as not being addresses. Now, admittedly, you can see that this helps us to debug and find problems in our model. For example, this one. So this one is being predicted as fairly positive that it is an address, but we've labeled it as not being an address. So you can see here, it thinks this is a street. It thinks my PO box is a street. This is wrong. Let's look at this one. So this one, it thinks it's not an address, but we've clearly labeled it as being an address because it has a PO box. So this is part of the address. Now, the reason it made this mistake is we haven't added a feature yet to explain to it what is a PO box. So let's add a feature. So we call this feature, in fact, let me just copy a couple of words. So we're going to take some words that are related to PO box. So there are different ways that you could write PO box, like PO.box, PO box. Like if you look through several examples, you'll see PO box being written in different ways. So we add a new feature. We call our feature PO box. We add a couple of words. And now we have a new feature. If we now retrain our model with this new information, we see that it learns. Now it correctly predicts our PO box, and our data is much better separated. So using this technique, we can easily train extractors or classifiers to teach a concept using no knowledge of machine learning, but only domain knowledge. Something that is important is having access to a large set of unlabeled data. You want to be able to explore the unlabeled set so that you can get some confidence that once you've built a model, you want to go through this big set of unlabeled data and find examples to make sure that your model is doing okay. For example, if I were to sample using predicted positives, I should be able to find an example that is being correctly predicted. So this, for example, is an address. It got my street, got the city, got the state, it got the zip. So the takeaways from this is that basically one person should be able to teach a system without any knowledge of machine learning, or if without being an engineer, you should be able to teach the system some concept that you want to teach it. And this knowledge should be able to be transferable. So if I were to start building a model, I should be able to hand it off to Alicia and say, you can continue doing this, which is often a problem with machine learning, is that people with very specific skills are not able to transfer that knowledge to the next person. Also, we haven't really touched on this in this particular demo yet, but the idea that you can decompose a problem into smaller problems. For example, if I were to include something like a phone number inside the address, I could build a smaller extractor that first extracts the phone number as part of my address extractor. So the idea to be able to decompose a problem into smaller problems and build separate extractors and compose extractors out of other smaller extractors is something that we feel helps us to scale with complexity. We mentioned that being able to explore a large set of unlabeled data is very important to make sure that the final model generalizes to a larger set of problems. And not get kind of stuck on a small set of training examples. We also feel that software engineering tools, such as version control systems and things that we've learned from the software industry, we can actually apply to machine learning to be able to share existing models. If I could quickly show you, for example, all the labels and features are actually stored in text format. So in our project where we added the PO box feature, you can say that this is just plain text. And so we can now use this system such as Git or CSV or some version control system to get a version history of our model over time. And I can also collaborate with other machine teachers and share our models in that way. So this is basically our takeaway. Thank you for watching.